Hi guys, welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Ashley Mova, and this is the daily show where we give you all the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Leading off the show today is John Campea.
Well, greetings and salutations, everybody. Welcome to the best damn movie-related show on the planet Earth, coming to you from right here at the Collider Video Studios here in Burbank, California, and we are so glad you decided to make us part of your day. They moved it around.
Also here is Mark Ellis.
I had the same exact issue last week looking at the cameras, but now I know which one I'm looking right down the barrel. I made the NCAA tournament.
Also here is Jeremy Jahns.
Welcome to the inaugural episode of me, for the first time without a jacket on Movie Talk.
What? Woo!
Crazy.
Also here, Kristian Harloff.
I took the BuzzFeed quiz of which Collider member are you, and I got Finstock for some reason. He's not even a member.
All right, let's get started.
All right, Warner Brothers and DC Films have released a new trailer for Wonder Woman. The 2-minute and 30-second trailer called Origin gives fans a better look at Diana Prince and the reasons why she left her home on the island of Themyscira to travel with American intelligence officer Steve Trevor in order to help bring an end to World War I. The movie stars Gal Gadot, Chris Pine, Robin Wright, Danny Houston, and Connie Nielsen. It opens in theaters on June 2nd. John, what do you think of the new trailer for Wonder Woman?
It's not as good as the other ones, but the other ones were so astronomically good that it's still a really good trailer. I liked it a lot, and I really like the fact that the marketing strategy Warner Brothers seems to be employing here with their trailers is that each trailer is revealing a little bit about the plot. Like the first one was just, the one they showed at Comic-Con was just image, which was fine because the movie was still so far away and it blew our socks off and I thought it was the best trailer of Comic-Con. The next one they showed, you started to get a sense of the outline. You understand the era of it. You understand who the villain is. You understand her need to get off the island. Okay. Now this one, they touch a little bit more into her on the island itself. You get a little bit into her mother, the secret origin, if you will, all that kind of stuff. So while this trailer didn't blow my socks off as much as the other ones did, I think it was a fantastic trailer built into the overall strategy of this film, revealing just a little bit more about the story. I feel now like I know what this movie is about. Now, some trailer campaigns think there's only two things, either show everything or show nothing. I think this Wonder Woman campaign is a great example of giving you just enough to give you an idea about what this movie is about, what the key pieces are, without giving away too much or without giving the story away entirely, and I think they did a great job. So, and I mentioned this to Kristian off camera, with this trailer, I am more convinced than ever. You remember I said a couple of weeks ago that I believe Wonder Woman will be the first DCEU film that gets over a 75% Rotten Tomatoes rating. I think this will be the first DCEU film. Remember, I'm saying DCEU, the Christopher Nolan Batman films do not count. This will be the first one that isn't completely divisive amongst movie fans. I think generally people are going to like this movie. I think critics are going to like this movie. And this trailer convinced me of two things. Number one, I'm more convinced of that than ever, that this will be a good movie. I think it's going to exceed that critic rating. But I'm also more convinced than ever that it will not be a really great movie because of Gal Gadot's performance. I still find her lines completely wooden. I equate Gal Gadot right now to Drax the Destroyer, Dave Bautista. I kind of put her on the same level as Dave Bautista. Dave Bautista is a great guy to use if you're James Gunn and you know how to use him right, hide his deficiencies as an actor, and he can come across great. And I think, you know, I think they're going to do the same thing with Gal Gadot in this film as well. I think they're going to find a way to make her accentuate what her strengths are, hide what her weaknesses are, and make the movie work much like they do for Drax and Guardians of the Galaxy. But overall, I think the most important thing to take away here is that Wonder Woman is going to be a good movie, and all the trailers so far have been top-notch. Mark Ellis, you've seen this third trailer now. What are your thoughts?
John, I think that this is the most nerve-wracking trailer as a movie fan to watch, because the paradox of being a huge movie lover is that we love seeing trailers, but we don't want too much given away when we see them. So the trailer that comes out the closest to the movie's release is usually when, oh, they gave away too much story. It's like, I want to have cake, but I also want to have abs. This trailer did a great job of showing us that we can have both cake and abs, because it gave us a little bit of those story points you guys are talking about, but it didn't show us exactly what we're going to be in for. And I love that they did that. And I thought Gal Gadot is going to be great in this movie because of what I saw in Batman v Superman. Like, I watched her in that, and I was like, okay, she's a level above Dave Bautista, where she can actually carry a movie. When I see Guardians of the Galaxy, I love watching Bautista, but I'm not like, this guy needs his own movie. When I saw Batman v Superman, I'm like, please, somebody give this person their own movie, because I want to get out of the movie I'm currently watching. But the trailer itself, I love the action in it. I think the way that she delivered the lines was note perfect, so I have nothing but good vibes going into this movie right now.
Jeremy.
I thought this trailer was great, and I do agree with you. When the last trailer comes around, it's usually, if I wasn't doing this and you know, the YouTube thing, I'd usually be like, do I want to watch it? Maybe I don't, because they have a tendency to show a bit too much. This one didn't. I've been theorizing for a while that the God of War Ares is going to be the bad guy in here, because it takes place during a world war. So at that line at the end where she says, what did she say, like, your wrath on this world is done or something like that, I think she's talking to him, but that's just me.
I think she was talking to DC critics.
They have confirmed that Ares is the villain, have they not, at this point? Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure they have.
I think they said something like that. But okay, cool. So I don't want to say I told you so, John, but shoot. I thought she was one of the standouts in Batman versus Superman also. And I think that, if it wasn't for Batman versus Superman, I'd be on your boat, like, this girl's a model and she shouldn't be Wonder Woman. But she was a standout in Batman versus Superman, so I want to see what she does in this one. It looks like there's a lot of pressure on Wonder Woman, because it's like, we don't want to say that the DCEU films have been divisive, but they have. So this is the one that can either bridge everything and bring everyone together, or if it's not good, this is when they really start thinking about rewrites and reboots. So we'll see what happens. No pressure.
What do you think?
There's stuff that you said that I agreed with you 100%, and then there's other stuff that you said that I couldn't. I was total opposite. Like, for starting with the plot of the movie, I agree with you 100%. I think that what they did so well in this was giving more of exactly what this movie is. I also agree that I think there's going to be, I think more critics and more fans are going to be on board with this than any other DC movie. It is my favorite trailer that they put out because of those reasons. And I think because of the fact that I wanted to know a little bit more, I saw an epic feel to it. It gave me a little bit more exactly kind of the feel of, in the beginning, it had that kind of, not that this was the best movie in the world, but I felt like that kind of like Troy in the beginning, and then it was like 300 in there, and there was a little bit more of that mythology leading into, obviously, where we're going to see Diana go and how she's going to transform into the person that we did see down the line in Batman v Superman, and learning more about her. That's what I liked is that thing about her that she can't know about who she is yet. The other thing is, I actually thought Gal Gadot was great in this trailer. I think that she is someone that has... When I looked at her originally, I was like, well, I don't know if casting the girl from Fast and Furious, she didn't have the build at time. At the time when they cast her, she got herself in shape. She has really kind of put herself, she's taken this role seriously. I think that, I also, by the way, love what Patty Jenkins has done and said as much with the parallels to the Donner Superman. Mm-hmm. She said that, and you could see it in the trailer. But going back to Gal Gadot, I think that there's something about her that I think she's gonna fool everybody. I think that she's really gonna come out of this and everyone's gonna be talking about her, because I couldn't keep my eyes off her. It's not because she's gorgeous. It's the fact that there was something about her owning this role. I think the action is obviously going to... I don't think that we're in disagreement that she's going to be able to pull off the stuff physically.
Oh, no. I think the trailers show that. She's going to look... And not just because she's beautiful, but in the movements and all, I think she's going to look great.
Everyone's going to buy that. But then I also think that she's going to get you emotionally. I'm put all in. I think she's going to be good.
You know, here's what I'm really hoping. I'm really hoping that there's a Channing Tatum situation here, because for years I said I think the worst actor working in Hollywood was Channing Tatum. Like, bar none, absolutely horrendous, terrible. But over the years and years and years and years, he's won me over. And now I'm a fan of Channing Tatum. I'm a fan of his now. I'm hoping the same thing here happens with Gal Gadot. Unfortunately, she was brutal in 999. She was terrible in Keeping Up with the Joneses. Although, let's give her a bit of a pass on that, because everybody was brutal in Keeping Up with the Joneses. She was bad in Criminal. And up to this point, other than Blind Faith, and I thought she delivered the lines in this trailer pretty wooden. I'm glad you like it. But, I mean, maybe this becomes the film. What was it? I think it was 21 Jump Street for me that made me go, You know what? Channing Tatum has found his groove. Maybe this will be the 21 Jump Street for me, for Gal Gadot. I mean, I don't know. I hope so.
I do like how you said that. Everyone was terrible in Keeping the Joneses, but Criminal, you gave a pass.
I said she was terrible in
Criminal. Yeah, but everybody was terrible. The guy who made Criminal retired. He's working
also,
at Panera.
Everybody in Criminal was terrible. And you had some very talented people in Criminal.
There's good acting in Criminal. The movie's terrible. There's good acting in Criminal.
I think on the Blu-ray box on Wonder Woman, it should be, this may be the 21 Jump Street for Gal Gadot.
This may be the 21 Jump Street.
I think that should be right on there.
But you cannot take away, no matter what doubts you bring in, because I'm bringing some doubts into the film as well, the trailers so far have been spectacular. And granted, we've had terrible movies that have had great trailers before, but right now all we have to go on is the trailers, and they look fantastic right now. The story sounds great. I love the direction they're going in.
And what these trailers are doing a great job of is separating themselves enough from the DCEU other movies. You know, it's not like, hey, remember when you loved Suicide Squad? Now you get Wonder Woman. Like, it feels like a standalone movie to where people who aren't necessarily fans of the DCEU prior to this, or even know there's a movie called Suicide Squad, or even Batman v Superman, they want to go see Wonder Woman. These trailers are doing a great job of furthering that cause.
All right, what's next?
I'm curious to know, though, did you guys find her accent distracting at all in the trailer?
No, because everyone had accents on her island.
I did find that the other Themyscirans were, I think, mimicking her accent.
Yes.
As opposed to expecting too much out of her as an actress to sound a certain way, they got everybody else just to mimic her to make it sound like that. And that's what a good director will do. Mm-hmm. But I think once I got past that and I realized, okay, because the first person who speaks in the trailer, and it is funny that her mother and Christopher Pine both have more lines in this trailer than Gal Gadot has. But once I got past that abrupt thing, it's like, this woman playing her mother is just trying to imitate her voice. But then I realized, well, that kind of makes sense. Yeah. And that's probably what they should be doing. And once that happened, I was okay with it.
No, it didn't bother me at all. I think that what it is because people know Wonder Woman and don't expect her to have an accent. I mean, I was sitting there with my wife, she's like, she has an accent now? I was like, well, they modeled it around the character. And I thought that it actually fit from where... It actually makes more sense to me from this land that she's from, so it didn't bother me.
Yeah, I think you'll probably see a lot of accents on that island, not just that one. I think once you see the movie, don't worry, guys. The movie's coming out. We can all see it and talk about the actual movie.
Like, why do people on a space station in a galaxy far, far away speak with a British accent?
Right. Because they came here and they left E.T.
Well, on Coruscant, they actually do have British accents.
At some point, you just got to accept it and move on, I guess. All right, what's next?
Deadline is reporting that Steven Spielberg, Tom Hanks, and Meryl Streep are all clearing their schedules to fast-track their new movie, The Post, in order to hit a release for this coming Oscar season. Steven Spielberg only said yes to the project this past Monday, and now deals are being finalized for Hanks and Streep to start production in late May. The drama will focus on the Washington Post's role in exposing the Pentagon Papers in 1971 and how the Post editor, Ben Bradley, and publisher Kay Graham joined the New York Times in challenging the federal government over their right to publish. It's expected to hit theaters by the end of the year. Christian, what do you think about Spielberg fast-tracking The Post into theaters by the end of the year?
That's ballsy, I'll tell you that much, for a lot of different reasons. One, and you know, not getting overly political here, I think that from what's going on in the news today and then looking at what this story is about, obviously it's going to be topical. And when you look at the people involved, they're going to have a certain point of view. Leave it at that. But what I will say is when you have a team like Steven Spielberg, Tom Hanks, Meryl effing Streep, you take the risk. You see what you can do. If they want to go for it, they're going to go for their award show. They're going to try to make a statement. Then this is a team. You say, okay, those three people, one of those people says that. And you go, okay, let's try. Let's see if they say they can get it done. But when all three say we can get this done, you give it a shot. It's going to be, it's a no small task. I'll tell you that.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I agree. They haven't filmed a thing. The year is one quarter of the way done or getting about there, and they're saying that they can do it by award season. Good luck to them. I can see why they want to do it, and I agree with you. When all three of them, it's like if one said yeah, then you know maybe. But when all three are like, no, we've been in this game for a couple of years now. I think we can actually get it done. I feel like, yeah, they can get it done. Hopefully they get the crew to get it done. Regardless of where you stand on any of them, when that team comes together, you got to admit, I mean, acting and directing wise, this is going to be a film that may very well be up for an award. I don't know, because I said that about Silence when I heard about Silence and saw the trailer for Silence. Who knows how it's going to go down? But looking forward to it, and good luck, guys, in getting that thing done 9 months from now, one school year.
Yeah, that's the thing that makes me nervous, that I feel like when this movie was announced and Spielberg was joining forces with Hanks and Streep, it's like, okay, this sounds like a great premise. It sounds like a very necessary movie in this day and age to make, but make sure it's good. Do not rush this thing and run the risk of having a movie that could have been an important statement to the guy in the White House that loves accusing the media of doing everything, to show them, and him in particular, that the media actually plays a vital role in how politics, our checks and balances factor into that. Don't rush this thing, and don't make this thing like, oh, okay, we just wanted to get out by the time award season happens, because we've seen that with movies before, where they try to rush or they try to rush the marketing, and it ends up backfiring because you didn't get the quality product you wanted. As long as they feel like their schedule will allow them to make the movie that this hopefully will be, then I'm totally fine with it. The fact that Tom Hanks and Meryl Streep, these aren't two dud actors. These are two of the best that have ever played the game. Steven Spielberg signs on, and they're like, okay, now we got this guy backing us, we're going to clear everything and make sure this is the priority. It kind of gets me excited and a little nervous.
Here's the thing. It all depends on how much preparation has already been done up to this point on this film. Because a lot of times you'll get some movies that have been in 3 months of pre-production before they nail down their leads, depending on the film. And some films can shoot in as little as 8 weeks or less. I mean, there are a lot of films that you guys have seen that have shot in 8 weeks or less. If they're not visual effects heavy films or action heavy films, then these types of shoots can actually happen and transpire very quickly. If you have one that doesn't have a lot of visual effects, also the post-production time gets shrunk up a lot. So if this is a little bit of a period piece, I guess, if they've already got a lot of work done on costumes, and if they've already got the script exactly where they want it to be, and if Steven Spielberg already has a bunch of storyboarding done, if they can lock in these two lead actors, then the concept of a non-visual effects heavy movie getting in front of the camera, shooting in like 12 weeks, and then going through its proper post-production in a 9-month period is actually not that ridiculous. When you're talking about maybe a 6-month period or 5-month period, it becomes unrealistic. But for a movie like this, with a guy who's been directed for 12 or 13 Academy Awards and won like 2 or 3 of them in Steven Spielberg, you got Tom Hanks, who's been nominated for Best Actor 5 times and one of the few living actors who actually won the award back to back. When you got somebody like Meryl Streep, who's like, what, 19 or 20 Academy Awards, Academy nominations?
She's lost count, John. Yes. She's lost count.
So if they've got these types of people involved with a story that they think is ready to go, I think it can be pulled off in time if Steven Spielberg thinks it can be pulled off in time. Because one thing that Steven Spielberg does not strike me as, at least when he's in the director's chair, is somebody who will compromise his vision. If Steven Spielberg has never been one to compromise his vision when he's in the director's chair, when he's just a producer taking a check and saying, yeah, I'm a producer on that, sure, whatever, we get Transformers too. But when he's in the director's chair, I think he takes that a lot more seriously. And I think if he says they can do it, I have a lot of faith they can.
You know what? They're two great actors. Just throw them in the fire. One shot. You get one shot. That's, if you mess up, we just keep going. Let's see that movie.
I remember there's this film instructor, and I took his course a number of years ago. His name's Dove S.S. Simmons. Tarantino actually took his program as well. But he has this great quote. He goes, everybody says it's so hard to make a movie. This is his great quote. He goes, realistically, here's the Hollywood truth. This is how you make a movie. Get a camera, put it on a tripod, get at least one friend in front of it, hit record, and 90 minutes later hit stop. You've made a movie. And so now at Spielberg and Streep and Tom Hanks, that maybe they can come up with something special. We'll see. All right, what's next?
It's Monday, which means it's time for the weekend box office report. Warner Brothers and Legendary's Kong Skull Island delivered a strong opening weekend performance, taking the number one spot at the box office with an estimated $61 million. In the number two spot is Fox's Logan, dropping 57.2% with $37.85 million. The third Wolverine spinoff topped $100 million domestically in just 5 days and is now at $152.7 million domestic. Universal and Blumhouse's Get Out took the number three spot with $21 million for a domestic total now at $111 million. Lionsgate's The Shack finished in the number four spot with $10 million in its second weekend. And WB's The Lego Batman Movie rounded out the top five with $7.8 million as its domestic total now climbs to just shy of $160 million. Mark, thoughts on Kong Skull Island's weekend debut.
I'm very happy to see my life coach at number one at the box office. I think he's going to have a great game against Godzilla in 2020. And Logan, I think it's a drop that we expected simply because it did so well opening weekend that you usually see with comic book movies. It's around that 55% drop area.
Most movies.
The
most
big movies. One for me, though, is Get Out, because Get Out only dropped 25% again, and I think it still made over $20 million. That is incredible. Incredible that it has that kind of repeat business, and I'm sure a lot of that is word of mouth. I don't think that Kong Skull Island is going to have the same word of mouth positivity where you need to rush out and see this in a theater. So I'd look for another drop from Kong Skull Island, especially because we know that there's another beast coming into theaters this weekend that everybody and their mother and their grandmother and their cousins, brothers, uncles, former roommate is going to go see. That would be Beauty and the Beast, John. It's a tale as old as time.
Jeremy.
Oh, I guess it's pretty serious. Kong. If you liked Kong, great. I wasn't crazy about Kong. So $61 million, like, is that low ball? Is that low for the March movies? What do you think? For some reason, I feel like you're more in tune with the box office than I am. I see 61.
Not really. Honestly, I was expecting 90.
Yeah, I was expecting
I don't know what it was
myself.
Tracking at. I was expecting
90. I don't
90.
Think it was tracking anywhere near that. Right. I think this is pretty in line with what they expected. I mean, again, Kong is somebody who's been in theaters a number of times, and to get people excited about it, if you had called this movie Skull Island, this thing is maybe doing $35-40 million dollars. Mm-hmm. The fact that, I mean, it's, you know, Kong was in the movie a lot. They put Kong in front of it. They clearly showed him in all of the marketing campaigns. I think that's why this movie did as well as it did. And I think the studio's pretty happy with that.
Yeah, Logan, I'm pumped that movie made its money back in 5 days or so. So it's all profit going from here. Get Out. I had a really, really interesting conversation about Get Out with my Uber driver last weekend. This is no lie. We just started talking about Get Out.
You and Uber drivers have good conversations.
It's a little better than yes. My Uber drivers see me. I have "Talk to Me" written on my forehead. And if you don't walk into that baby with headphones on, you're locked in for about 45 minutes. But we were talking about how Get Out was like such a surprise, written by Peele from Key and Peele. I love that it's doing well. It's a horror movie that's made how much money now?
Get Out?
Yeah.
$111 million on a $4.5 million budget.
That's crazy. Like, that's absolute insanity, but it's wonderful. I want to see what Peele does next. I still don't know what The Shack is about, and I'm glad Lego Batman's holding on, because like I always say every week, because it's on this list every week, Lego Batman is a proper spoof movie, so I love it.
I don't know how the studio... I like Kong Skull Island. I said in my review was this, is that if you made a checklist going into the movie of all the things it has to do right, and then a list of all the things you'd like to see it do right, it did all the things it had to do right, didn't really check off many of the boxes that you would like to have seen it done right, but it did do the things it needed to do. I walked out entertained by Kong Skull Island, although not very memorable. I don't know that the studio can be very happy with it, though, when they spend $185 million on making. You don't spend $185 million pre-marketing on a movie expecting a $60 million open. Like, you expect better than that. And I think this is concerning because, granted, the trailers weren't great until that last trailer. That last trailer I thought was bonkers good. And maybe that was enough. I thought maybe that would be enough to get people into the theaters. I think if I'm the studio right now, if I'm Universal, I'm a little bit nervous about the future of this universe, considering they weren't able to get that many people.
This was Warner Brothers.
I'm taking that back. You're absolutely right. Yeah. It was Warner Brothers. I went and saw this at Warner Brothers, so I should know that.
If I'm the studio, too, I'm also saying that a lot of that $185 million is probably going to be made overseas. I think Kong has a lot of appeal.
I don't think you're wrong about that.
I think Godzilla certainly has international appeal. There's no secret that they're trying to tie those movies together for a joint movie in a couple of years. So I think as long as this movie can hold water in the United States, people everywhere around the world know who Kong is. They know who Godzilla is. They want to see these beasts fight. So it's going to be doing just fine overseas.
It has made $81 million overseas. Right now it's sitting at $142 million internationally. Logan, again, I thought it would have about a 40% drop, but more people went out to go see King Kong.
It was tracking at around $55 million. And I think that when you put it up against something like Logan was in second week, yet Beauty and the Beast, I don't think that the studio was expecting it to do as big as you guys think. I think that when you put it in March, if they wanted to do those kind of 100, I saw somebody saying it's a bomb. It's not a bomb.
No, it's not close. A bomb.
It's going to also be able to kind of just pitter-patter through, get, you know, between, it's not going to be a massive hit. You know, obviously, every time you put a big movie out like this, you want it to be a massive hit. But they were fighting against that from the releases in general. All the stuff that we have and all the real estate that's taken up, and even in April and May through August, March is becoming now a little bit more crowded. Look at the March that we have so far with this movie, with Logan, with Power Rangers, you know, with Beauty and the Beast. It's a stacked month. So it's also not traditionally when people are going out to spend so much money opening weekend on movies. That's when most people are out of school. It's summertime, and so this is an okay opening. I actually didn't like, the more and more I think about the movie, I'm more and more disappointed with it. I think Kong was great. There's more that they could have done with the movie overall. It was pretty dull for them, except when Kong was fighting. And I want to see what's going to happen with Godzilla vs. Kong. That movie will do good. That is a marquee matchup. That it's not, this is not going to hurt that at all.
All right, what's next?
We're going on into
buy and sell.
Just as Edgar Wright's new movie, Baby Driver, premiered at this year's South by Southwest Film Festival, a new trailer has dropped online, giving fans their very first look. The film stars Ansel Elgort as a young getaway driver suffering from tinnitus who listens to music to drown out the ringing in his ears. Written and directed by Wright, the film also stars Kevin Spacey, Lily James, John Bernthal, John Hamm, and Jamie Foxx. Baby Driver opens in theaters on August 11th. Jeremy Byersell, the first trailer for Edgar Wright's Baby Driver.
I'm absolutely buying this trailer for sure. I'm buying this every bit as much as I can inform you guys that I absolutely have a golden tan on my arms. Golden goodness, folks. You know that for sure. I love this trailer. I think it's fantastic. At first, it looked like the Need for Speed movie that we didn't get. I mean, I enjoyed Need for Speed for its dumb fun funness that it is. But this at first looks like a Need for Speed movie. Then it goes into more of a crime movie. So it's crime meets racing, meets Need for Speed, meets the Fast and Furious before it was a heist movie, but before, like, after it was a racing movie. It looks like a hodgepodge of a bunch of different crime genres. I think it's fantastic. It looks witty, so I'm buying this for sure.
Would you say Gone in 60 Seconds?
Better.
Okay. Mark.
Thought I'd make a play. I'd go Gone in 60 Seconds. I like that movie, and I like this trailer too, Jeremy. All right. I'll tell you why. Because it looks fun. It looks like a lot of fun at the box office. I think it's an interesting tick for Ansel Elgort to have. Jamie Foxx looks really great. Everybody in this movie looks fantastic. Kevin Spacey looks like he's going to steal the show when he's in the movie. And Edgar Wright behind the camera, I give this thing a little bit more credibility than I might otherwise just seeing this trailer. And it's interesting that this trailer just dropped because I'm also hearing things out of South by Southwest where, by and large, people that have actually screened this movie are saying it's pretty good. So that gets me excited about what I'm going to see with Baby Driver.
I absolutely 100% buy this trailer. Interesting note, right now, Baby Driver is holding a 100% on Rotten Tomatoes. Granted, it's 12 reviews right now for people who are South by Southwest.
Those are 12 legit tomatoes.
I'm going to make a radical prediction that that rating is going to go down.
You're drunk.
I will not go up from 100%. It will, in fact, go down. How much, I'm not really sure.
103% opening weekend, $200 million.
This trailer was bonkers good. It felt like Guy Ritchie at his best kind of a movie. I think I turned to you and said that. I said, man, this kind of feels like Guy Ritchie firing on all cylinders, but it's another great director. It's Edgar Wright, which is fantastic. The cast looks wonderful, and I will watch anything with Lily James in it. The girl who made Disney live-action films work when she was in Cinderella, she even made me like Pride, Prejudice, and Zombies, which was so much better than its predecessor, that Abraham Lincoln vampire thing from the same creative team, yet she made that movie work. She looks spectacular in this. Look, a girl with an actress with a massive accent can actually pull off something other than her natural accent. I think she looked wonderful in this. The cast looks amazing. This film, I was looking forward to it just because it's Edgar Wright. This trailer was far better than I thought it was going to be, and I cannot wait to see this movie. Huge buy for me.
I knew nothing about this movie going into it except, like you said, Edgar Wright. So, and then I heard some people I knew that saw it at South by said it was okay. Other people loved it. So I was like, okay, let's check it out. Huge buy. I am so excited for this movie. It's like Hollywood old school and Hollywood new school, like, together, but doing like a, kind of an older premise, but with a new twist. And that shot of the car when he's driving it, and it, like, the way it maneuvers
he
through that alley.
Spins around through two different trees.
But it was done
crazy.
In such a way that I was like, oh yeah, that guy can do that. And it didn't feel like movie magic. It felt like, oh, that's what this kid can do. So, and it was like elements, like you said, Gone in 60 Seconds and Drive and other things. I think that it's like some people who were disappointed with what Drive ultimately was, and undeservedly so, like, because it wasn't the first couple trailers for that movie were pitched as like an action over the top film, and then when you saw it, it was a lot deeper of a film. It was a different movie, but some people were very disappointed. I think that some people sued because it was a remember that stupid
it did.
Story.
They got sued because the movie was not what the
right.
trailer said it was.
This
right.
movie, I think, is what those people were expecting.
Yes,
this movie looks new. It looks fresh. It looks like they've been touting Ansel as this up and coming star. This looks like the movie that can do it. What I hope doesn't happen. What has happened with Edgar Wright movies is not enough people see him. We all rave about them, whether it's the Coronado mm-hmm. trilogy or whether it's Scott Pilgrim. See this movie. This is the type of movie that you want to talk, whether it's Nice Guys or Ex Machina, to where they just kind of people buzz about them, but not enough of the mass people see it. See it, because this is something that I think can be really fun.
You gave me a great idea for a career change. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to set up like a desk, and I'm going to have like a suit. I'm going to open up the legal offices of Mark Ellis, Esquire, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to be perched up at an AMC theater near you, and when you come out of a movie and you're disappointed, you just walk right up to my desk, sit you down, you actually get to meet and talk to me, and we will sue the theater or sue the studio if you didn't like the movie. You see this young boy right here? He just wanted to watch Transformers. He just wanted to see his childhood heroes all grown up. He didn't like the movie. So you know who he hired? This guy. Let's get him, Jeremy.
Let's do it, Mr. Ellis. I thank you.
It should be pointed out that you are still not rich, correct?
No, I'm not. Right. But neither is he. But he's a great lawyer.
All right, what's next?
A new clip from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 debuted this past weekend at Nickelodeon's Kids' Choice Awards. Featuring everyone's favorite team of space criminals, the new look shows a bit of a disagreement between Star-Lord and Rocket Raccoon and how Drax could settle the argument. Along with the new clip, director James Gunn has also confirmed the movie will have a post-credit scene. Taken to Twitter to answer a fan's question, Gunn said, "All I'll say is, unless you have to rush out because your mother is dying, stay through the entire end credits." John Byers saw the first clip from Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2.
Oh, I buy it, but I love that comment from James Gunn. That's awesome. Which it actually makes you start to instantly wonder, what could they have in the post-credit scene? It's obviously got to be Thanos doing something mm-hmm. significant, not just grabbing a glove and going, "I'll do it myself," like something stupid. I think he's going to be doing something significant that directly sets up what's moving forward in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I buy the clip. I thought it was really funny. Again, they seem to be putting a lot of the focus on Drax in a lot of the marketing, and it's funny one-liners. And once again, he gave a pretty damn funny one-liner in this. What did he say? My turds are famously yeah. large, or something along those lines. I thought that was great. Now, something interesting has happened. I should at least point this out. Now, this was debuted this past weekend on television, and it was online. But when we checked earlier, just this morning, the clip had been removed from a few sites, apparently due to studio request. I don't know what's going on there, why the studio request has been taken down when it's already been aired on television. I'm not really sure. It is still online in some places, not in others. So I don't know what the story is with that. Maybe you will be able to find it online. Maybe you won't. But overall, I thought the clip was pretty good.
Yeah, I'm going to buy it also. I don't think it was necessarily gut-busting, but I don't think it really had to be. I think what it did was showcase the dynamic once again and to showcase what sometimes in certain movies, and I go back to the first Thor. I know some people disagree with me, but I thought Kat Dennings was just completely useless in that movie, and I like Kat Dennings. The humor itself, when humor is done right, it's like Guardians of the Galaxy. The way that it's put together, because you've already accepted that this is how they're going to interact with one another. Yet when it comes time for it to be epic and the action scenes, it's going to deliver that way too. But I think the focus was once again on Batista, because like you were mentioning before, Batista was a guy that you'd watch and be like, "Oh, he is not The Rock," and not many people are. That's why The Rock is The Rock, but you wondered whether or not he was going to have a film career. But the way that he kind of the role of Drax is not, it's not Shakespeare.
No, but you don't need a seasoned thespian to play Drax.
No, but you also from what they're relying on him to do is nail those comedy moments, and comedy is not easy. And he, from what we've seen so far in these clips, has really impressed me. Now, we'll see what's going to happen in the movie, but they've been leaning on him in these clips, whether it's him sitting around when they're talking about each other's their feelings.
Yeah.
Every line that he's hit so far has been getting some big laughs. So I think that you got to give credit to Batista so far, the fact that they're leaning so hard on him in the marketing.
Jeremy.
You know what's funny is I was wondering why they had a poop joke as the backbone of this trailer, and then I found out it aired on a kid's channel. I was like, okay, it makes a little more sense right there. I love
kids like poop. Poop and slime. Yeah.
Kids like poop, kid. You stay with me, you'll be all right. Gack, coming at you live. I wasn't crazy about that. I like the back and forth of the Guardians of the Galaxy, but for some odd reason, I'm like, Larry the Cable Guy's not in this movie. Stop with the poop joke. So, I mean, if the poop joke was in the... It works on... It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia, mm-hmm. but for me, in Guardians of the Galaxy, it just didn't work for me whatsoever. If you want to talk about more shit, we have Transformers The Last Night. We're going to talk about that soon. Mark, what did you think?
I think that's one big Batista turd we're going to be talking about next. In the meantime, after watching this clip, I'm confident I will not be filing a lawsuit on behalf of my client, Jeremy, for Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. This is what I wanted to see, too, because I like seeing Rocket and Star-Lord. Like, the first material we ever saw, it seemed like Rocket might be stranded from the rest of the Guardians for a bulk of the movie, and it doesn't appear that's the case, and I love when they're all interacting and throwing one-liners back and forth together. So this clip gives me a lot of confidence in that, and the news that there's going to be a post-credit scene is literally a shock to no one at all, and there's a lot of family members I could have in peril that I would say, you're going to have to wait another 5 minutes because I have to watch a little bit more Guardians goodness.
All right, what's next?
The first clip from the upcoming Transformers Last Night has been released. The fifth movie in the blockbuster action series arrives in June, with the new clip introducing its young star, Isabella Monterlong, with new Autobot named Canopy. Along with the clip, Paramount also released its new TV spot that finally reveals new look at the Dinobots. Mark Wahlberg returns from 2014's Transformers Age of Extinction and will be joined by Anthony Hopkins, Josh Duhamel, Stanley Tucci, and John Goodman. Transformers Last Night opens on June 23rd, 2017. Kristian, buy or sell the new clip and TV spot for Transformers The Last Night.
You had to go to me on this one. I can't sell this stupid movie enough, and I sell it because of Michael Bay. You just look at it, and it's like the same crap. It's like the glossy nonsense with the bullshit dialogue, and it's like, I hate it already, and I'm not getting sold on this trailer. It's the same crap, and the only thing that I did say is the music is so good. Steve Jablonski.
Always good.
Steve Jablonski is good. So good, and it keeps me like, it just gives me hope that something's going to happen in this movie, but it looks like the same, it looks like a commercial, like a music video, and it's just, there's not, he can't, it's like, shoot, you wanted to change it and make it different. It looks the same. The clips that they put out, the little TV spot, I haven't even seen this movie, and I hate it already. I'd sell it.
When it comes to Transformers World, I'm known for two things. Number one, other than the first Transformers, which I loved, I hated all the movies, but I love all the marketing every time, no matter what. And I think the trailers for this movie have been awful. And this is the worst of them all. And, you know, when you hear a lot of people complain, and Transformers, the series, the film franchise, I should say, has a fan base. There are fans out there who truly love it. But amongst those who are critics of the franchise so far, one of the things a lot of people will complain about is it's over-reliance, it's always humans. Everything's about the humans. We want to go see Transformers. So they put out this piece of marketing that's like, oh, little kids running with Ed 209. I'm surprised you didn't go there with that. Apparently, Ed 209 is in this movie.
Insult to Ed 209.
Insult to injury. They add Ed 209 to it, and it looked awful. But not only did it look like Ed 209, you pointed out something else that looked even more like.
Yeah, it was the geckos from Metal Gear Solid 4. I saw it immediately. I was like, that is a gecko from Metal Gear Solid 4. The pivoting head, the gun, the bipedal feet, the way he walks. It was completely it for sure. Are you throwing it to me now? Now I'm just running with it? Okay, here it is. Well, one thing I can say is you're right. The Transformers trailers, like Transformers Dark of the Moon still has a good trailer. I can actually watch that trailer with the music and enjoy it, even though I saw it. You know, it's just the way it stands up. But I agree with you. The trailers for this one have been noticeably worse. And one thing I can say is the trailer campaigns for this particular Transformers movie have been more honest, probably, because no one wants to hire attorney Mark Ellis over here because the trailer weren't honest. It looks bad. It probably is going to be bad. Like Drax before Michael Bay, his turds are famously large, and that was that is long. Long in 2 hours and 40 minutes. I can't wait for this one. Oh, my God. Yeah.
Kids. Mark.
You know, John, I haven't been a fan of the Transformers movies to this point, and this ad had a lot of kids in it. And if you know one thing about me, you know that I love the wonderment in a child's eye. It just, like... It's so obvious what they're doing now, though, is that they've given up on us. They've given up on people like us, people who grew up playing with Transformers toys in the 80s and 90s. They have, that ship has sailed. They hope that we're taking our kids to see it. This is going after the kids because they're trying to hook. It's like a drug.
I saw Stranger Things. Let me put a kid's cap. That's exactly what Michael Bay did.
No, but it's also like kids are going to see this and they're going to be like, oh, he's like a dog. The robot's like a dog. I'm going to go see this movie. And adults aren't going to do that. So we're going to pan this movie. It's going to make a crap ton of money and the cycle just repeats itself. The bottom line is I'm going to do a lot of drugs instead of go see this movie.
Nice. You know what? I don't know why. I have this little itch in the back of my brain telling me this movie might be good.
No.
Only reason, and this is terrible logic that nobody should ever follow. I loved all the marketing for the other ones and hated the movies.
Right.
I hated the marketing for this one. Maybe it'll flip around.
That's why go to Vegas every week. Right. It's like, hey, I didn't have a great weekend this week.
Or at least you walk out and at least a win would be, it wasn't terrible.
That'd
be a win, but I don't know.
I'll take that at this point.
We were all here like 3 months ago, and we're like, oh, this movie's got time travel and Hitler and King Arthur. This is going to be ridiculous. God, what I wouldn't give for some King Arthur fighting Hitler right now in this movie. Right. It'd be better than what I saw today.
If Michael Bay, you know, I'm going to say right now, I will crown Michael Bay a national hero if he actually gives us a scene of Merlin with Excalibur in his hand fighting a Nazi Hitler and taking down Hitler. If I see that, I'm going to be all in on
all
this movie.
Is
I
don't redeemed.
I'll forgive everything else, and I'll be all in on this movie.
If that
just
happens,
for the balls. Well,
but Kung Fury's going to come in too, apparently.
I would love to see that. And if we see King Arthur go up against Hitler one-on-one, I will stand up and I will say, Your Honor, objection withdrawn.
You realize the spirit of Hitler is going to possess a Decepticon, and that's going to be the new Galvatron.
No, it's Optimus Prime. That's Optimus Prime, remember?
That's what it is. Optimus with his purple eyes stabbing Bumblebee is the spirit of Hitler.
The Decepticons took Hitler's brain and put it into Optimus Prime's head, connected it with the Matrix of Leadership, and now Optimus Prime is a transforming...
Cut the cameras. I'm writing this down. This is good stuff. Cut the cameras. We don't want to let the outside world know this yet.
All right, well, guys, listen, I want to make sure you guys know this is not the only show on Collider Video. There's a lot of other stuff going on. Don't forget, a little bit later today, the brand new episode of Josh McCuga and Crew with TV Talk will be online just a little bit later today. Also, last night, the brand new episode of The Walking Dead recap show here on Collider was also on. And, of course, the brand new episode of Jeremy Johnson's Awesome Tacular. There's a new episode. There's a link for it in the description below. And many of you wrote to us, and you noticed that there was not a new episode of the next round of the March Movie Madness Villains Tournament this past week. I was ill on Thursday. I wasn't able to shoot it, so we're going to shoot that this Thursday. Keep your eye open for that. So listen, guys, at the end of the show, we're going to take some time, take some of your live Twitter questions. You can start firing those in right now to @ColliderVideo on Twitter. Make sure you're following us there, and Wendy will pick a couple out. But before we get to that, let's go to the mailbag. Ashley, what is in the mailbag today?
Janet writes, hey, Collider crew, saw the news that James Cameron has delayed Avatar 2 again when it was finally announced it would drop in 2018. This keeps happening, so I wonder, the longer it keeps getting delayed, do you think it will actually hurt its box office? The longer the delay, the more people can forget and maybe not care anymore.
Yeah, but remember, there's a difference between being hurt and being crippled. I think that the longer the delay, the more it hurts the film. I agree. But I do not believe it will cripple the film. So, like, when Avatar comes out, if it would have made $205 million opening weekend, now it'll make $180 million opening weekend. And we'll look at the $180 and go, hey, it was still spectacular, yes, but it would have done better. But will it go from $205 million opening weekend to a $61 million opening weekend? No. It's not going to... You know, it's not going to hinder the film that much. Will it hurt? Yes, a little bit. We'll notice it a little bit, but ultimately it'll be judged on its own merits and people still go see it. But no, I completely agree that the further away we get from the phenomena that was the first Avatar, the less and less they're going to reap the benefits of it, but not so much so that it's going to make it a flop by any stretch of the imagination. I don't know, Mark, what do you think?
Well, John, it's a slippery slope, isn't it? Because it's kind of like when you're a guy and you shave your sideburns, you know? So it's like okay, I'm gonna do here, and then you try to cut this one, and then you cut this one a little too high, you're like, ah, damn it, I got to go back to this one. And then you just keep going up and up and up until you're a very pale Mr. T. I don't want that to happen with Avatar 2. I don't think it's going to. You have to delay it 6 months or whatever this is going to be. I think that's a very negligible difference at the box office, but we've already had so much time pass since the first Avatar that from where this movie was going to be released versus where it's going to be now, I don't think that itself is going to hamper it. I think the damage has already been done by the fact that we didn't go back to Pandora for a decade before the movie came out initially.
And remember, originally, that the next Avatar movie was supposed to come out was officially scheduled for 2015.
I'm talking about this release, this most recent release that we had before that got pushed back.
Jeremy.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure here someone asked the question, like, Avatar is supposed to come out in 2018. Do you think that's going to happen? We were all like, there's no way. There's no fucking way it's coming out in 2018. Here it is getting pushed back again. But I do agree that this is why studios strike while the iron's hot. We see it all the time where a movie totally crushes and then the sequel comes out in like a year or two and usually isn't as good, but it makes money because it's still hot on people's minds. If Avatar didn't come out in the first... after the first 3, 4, or 5 years since the first one, yeah, it's like it can be 10 or 20 years now. I mean, it's going to make less money as time goes on. Is it going to make as much money as the first Avatar? No. But, as time goes on, it will lessen it, but it's still going to be, I think, a box office success spread across the 7 Avatar sequels he's making right now.
Normally, I would say, if it was anybody else, I'd say, just scrap this thing already. It's you're pushing it back. You keep pushing it back. I never doubt James Cameron. I don't care if he's 99 years old making movies. I'm still not going to doubt the guy because when Avatar came out in the first place, who in the hell thought it was going to be Titanic? Nobody. There's not one person in the world. You're full of crap if you thought that's going to be the all-time movie. Still, worldwide, it is still the all-time movie.
And who made Titanic? It's like,
so it's like, you know, it certainly doesn't help it because the thing is what has also happened with Avatar, there are a lot of people, that happens a lot when ever something's very popular, people start to hate on it. I think La La Land is the most recent example of that. But Avatar's a little different to where it's like, it's people thinking it's unoriginal, it hasn't aged very well, it doesn't work the same way unless it's watched in a theater. It hurts it, but it's still James Cameron. There's going to be new things that he introduces. He also is a marketing genius. There are things that you're going to see. So I don't think it's going to hurt because of what he does and the way that he's able to do further technology. I think that we're going to go want to check out James Cameron's new toys.
All right, guys, so I said we're going to save a little bit of time to get to your live Twitter questions, and we're going to do that right now. Once again, make sure you're following us on Twitter at @ColliderVideo. Wendy, what have you picked out?
The first one comes from Andrew David G, who writes, despite the Transformer movies, do you think Michael Bay would do good with the G.I. Joe movie franchise?
No.
I don't think I'm the first one to say that. Yes, I think he would do okay with it. That is right in Michael Bay's wheelhouse. Look, and as much as we crap on Michael Bay for what he's done with the Transformers and all
giant
that kind of
turds.
Stuff. Giant turds. Giant turds. I still love the first one. Look, he has made some really good movies, too. Everybody loves The Rock. Armageddon is actually one of my guilty pleasures. I enjoy that. I thought...
the Oscar-winning 13 Hours?
13 Hours. Pain and Gain, I thought, was quite good. So look, this guy is capable. And when you're talking about G.I. Joe, Mark, I think you were the one who pointed this out to me. You're talking about a movie that would be tailor-made for a Michael Bay-directed film. Am I saying a Michael Bay-directed G.I. Joe would be amazing? I'm not saying that. But I'm saying if you were to put Michael Bay on anything that would... as get you as close to guaranteed success as you could, pairing Michael Bay with G.I. Joe is like the dream matchup if you're trying to match Michael Bay with something. So I don't know. That's kind of my thoughts on it.
No, because I'll tell you why. It's the thing that's been done wrong with G.I. Joe in the first place, they've been basing it off a lot of the animated, the way that was done, the cartoon that came out like in the 80s, and even then it went off the wrong path. They should have been going off the Marvel Comics version of it because that's when the best storylines came out of it too. Michael Bay wouldn't, with 13 Hours, can he shoot? That was a better movie than stuff that he's done. But the difference is he wouldn't be shooting this like that. He would be going more towards the Transformers thing because he would, because with 13 Hours, he was paying respects and he did it in a classy way for the way that he was doing that particular film. He wouldn't be doing that with G.I. Joe. It wouldn't be like a military movie. It would be slow motion, glossy. There'd be just completely, it would be the same crap.
This could be only because this guy, if anything else, the one thing you know James Michael Bay for other than gratuitous bent over motorcycle shots is that he loves and honors the military.
Exactly.
And I don't think he would
In true stories, but not in G.I. Joe.
But I think he would bring that to G.I. Joe because of his love of the military.
I'll tell you who I think that would be, do a great G.I. Joe. I think Joe Carnahan would be a great G.I. Joe director.
I think there's like 1,000 directors that would do a better G.I. Joe movie that like I'd actually want to go see, but I don't hate the idea of Michael Bay doing a G.I. Joe movie because I think it's in his wheelhouse to some extent, and I also think that the idea you and I came up with on Mailbag a couple weeks ago is if you have the Transformers and G.I. Joe crossover, fine, let him make those movies because, let's be honest here, the ship has sailed on me caring about a Michael Bay Transformers movie, and I don't, even though I like the last G.I. Joe movie, I'm not like waiting for the new one to be announced. So if Michael Bay has that to distract him, then it means he's not going to come into any other franchise and taint that one for me. So it's almost like, here's your ball, just go play with it somewhere else and don't ruin the rest of our movies. That's what I'd like to see happen. Do G.I. Joe Transformers.
Chairman.
Joe versus Cobra and the kids save the day in the end because Stranger Things was big. I mean, that's pretty much what it would be. Now, if you asked me in the late 90s or early 2000s about that, I would have said, oh, hell yeah, get Michael Bay on G.I. Joe. But because of his body of work lately, I can't say yes, because what makes it different than The Rock or even 13 Hours is that G.I. Joe has very specific, like the character of the Joes are very important, and you need, like, and there's an ensemble of them. There's a lot of them, and you need to do them all justice. And so far, I haven't seen him be able to do that in a lot of, like, Armageddon's probably the best ensemble of characters that shine that he's actually done. That's me going, Armageddon was more than it's still a guilty pleasure movie, but as of now, I got to say no to the G.I. Joe thing, but if we can go back in time and pluck Michael Bay from the 90s before the aliens took him and replaced him, then yeah, sure, go for it.
And let me be clear, Michael Bay is not the first director I would pick to direct a G.I. Joe movie.
But I'm just saying, hypothesized.
G.I. Joe movie would be the first movie I would pick for Michael Bay if Michael Bay was going to do one.
How excited would we be if they said, like, Peter Berg or Catherine Bigelow was going to be doing a G.I. Joe movie?
We would lose our minds.
Yeah.
Everybody would lose their minds. All right, what's next?
Lost my place. All right, here we go. Found you. Javed Valiev, who writes, since the disaster artist received standing ovation at South by Southwest, do you think we'll see more comedies directed by James Franco?
Okay. Never get too excited or too down about audience response at a film festival. Because there have been movies where you hear people were walking out of this movie, and it turned out to be a really good movie that most critics liked and most audiences liked. You've heard standing ovations at this one festival somewhere, and it turns out to be a movie that critics like and audiences don't like. I wouldn't get too excited about it yet. I am very intrigued by The Disaster Artist, but I wanted to get out of the festival first and get out to where more audiences can see it. Not the audiences in Austin aren't real audiences. Get out to a wider audience, and then let's make a decision like that. Look, if James Franco can take this concept and make it funny and entertaining to watch, then by all means, I want to see him do more. I think he's a really interesting artist. It'd be cool to see.
I completely agree, but let's see what happens. I have been looking forward to this movie. It was supposed to come out last year, and I'm very encouraged that it got good responses, but I agree. Sometimes they get caught up in it. There's a couple of laughs, and maybe they give it a better review than maybe it should, but I have very high hopes for this movie. I have heard some buzz from people that I actually really enjoy their take on it and take on movies. So I can't wait to see this movie. And if it is funny, then yes, we're all going to be saying, if we all go and see that movie and laugh harder than we've laughed in a long time, and it's because a lot of the directing that James Franco, we're all going to be saying, please direct something soon. So it just makes sense.
Yeah, well, I mean, even if we all laugh and people who watch the movie like it, if the movie doesn't make money, I doubt we're going to see a lot more from James Franco. So it's one of those money talks things. If you want to see James Franco direct more, then go watch his movie. But I do agree, in terms of festivals, you know, you hear about people walked out of Pulp Fiction during, I think it was Cannes or something like that. Yeah. They walked out of Pulp Fiction. Now, if you walk out of Pulp Fiction and go, then no, your friend slaps you in the head. It's just the way it would be. So, yeah, I want to see more directed by James Franco if this is good, but I can't tell you until I see it.
Mark?
I would like to see a James Franco-directed movie. He clearly has a passion for making the movies his way. He'll do a big-budget movie or a ridiculous comedy sometimes just to be able to do a more artistic project, and the guy has really good comedic timing. When you watch him in movies like The Interview or This Is the End, or whatever that Bryan Cranston boyfriend movie was, he was really funny in those. Like, he gets comedic timing on screen, not necessarily hosting award shows. When he's in a movie, he really knows how to make the play right. So I think he could do that behind the camera, especially if he's directing people who he has a very good relationship with, people who he's known for years, his buddies, his friends. I would look to see more comedies from James Franco, and I'd be excited about checking them out.
All right, what's next?
Thomas Bergstrom writes, IMAX and Prime have a higher ticket price. Does the studio get more money / tickets from those, or do the theater take a larger cut?
Correct me if I'm wrong. If I understood my conversations with the people at AMC right when I was still with AMC, I believe the percentage stays the same. So if the higher the ticket price, regardless of the theater that it's in, I believe that the studio still takes X percentage, as much as they take the same percentage from a $10 ticket. That is the way I understood it when it was explained to me. Things could have changed. It's been a couple of years since I worked with AMC, or maybe it wasn't explained to me right. But my understanding is the percentage split stays the same regardless of the ticket pricing. Have you guys heard any differently?
Yeah, John, if I may, I used to work concessions in a movie theater, so I think I know what I'm talking about here. Movie theaters make all their money on corn sales. It's all corn and soda. They get a little percentage from the ticket.
Yeah,
all corn.
In terms of what I understand, it's the bulk of what they make their money on is concessions. So if you have a luxurious theater and more people are going to it, you're going to naturally get more money from the popcorn, the Twizzlers, the Red Vines, rather.
I see what
Twizzlers.
You're doing right now. You're a highfalutin projectionist. And ooh, I'm Jeremy. I get to be in a booth away from everybody else. Look at the little peon Mark having to slub popcorn to people.
You're no peon. You're my lawyer. I'm going to need you in a few minutes, okay?
Although I've mentioned this quote before, but there's a great quote by somebody at NATO, which is not the defense organization. It's actually the North American Theater Owners Association. It's not
arguably
a real thing.
Is important.
Yes. At a big conference they were at, this one theater owner said this great quote, and it's very, very true. He said to all these thousands of movie theater owners, he goes, "We are not, as movie theater owners, we are not in the movie business. We are in the candy business." And it's actually, that quote is probably the most reflective of the reality of the economics in the movie theater industry.
And then he sang the song The Candy Man Can from Willy Wonka. It was really weird for everybody.
All right, last question of the day.
Okay, last one comes from Trevor Batson, who writes, with Stallone in Guardians of the Galaxy 2, would you see Schwarzenegger in a MCU or other comic book movies?
Ooh,
I think he's doing
possible.
Good on
it. I mean, anything's possible.
I think he's crushing it on those mobile app commercials. I think he's doing
first Counter Strike or whatever that game's called. Join me and strike. I can't do an Arnold.
Get to the chopper.
They asked me to be the She-Hulk. I'm not going to do it. I tried The Apprentice, didn't work out. So do something else. Maybe be in a Star Wars movie. Maybe just go ahead and take a nap.
Arnold, a lot of people were speculating you might want to play Cable in Deadpool 2. Do you have comedic chops?
Well, that's fantastic that they would say that. But no, I'm not really looking forward to the Cable. I like DirecTV.
I also heard that your schedule is very busy interviewing new housemates. How's that going?
I would rather not comment on that. You're very funny. Won't you put on your wedding ring?
Oh, boy.
Well, my wife and I don't wear wedding rings. So. All right, guys, that'll do it for us. Thank you so much for joining us for this installment of Movie Talk. Listen, don't forget, lots of other great programming here on the channel. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. Just go over there, click that subscribe button, and keep up to date on everything going on in the world of film and everything going on here at Collider. I want to thank the guys sitting at the table with me. First of all, Mr. Mark Ellis, where can people find you?
You can check me at a bar tomorrow night watching the Demon Deacons take on the Kansas State Wildcats in the kind of first round of the NCAA tournament. It's the play-in game. You can also find me on Twitter at Mark Ellis Live. And this Wednesday, 7 p.m. PST, the Schmoes Know Live show is back with our guest Josh McDermott from The Walking Dead.
Right beside me, Mr. Jeremy Jahns.
You can find me at Jeremy Jahns on YouTube, Twitter, the rest of the internet. You can find my show Awesome Tacular on the Verizon Go 90 network. New episodes every Friday, and you can find me 8 days a week in the tanning beds. Totally where I am.
Kristian Harloff.
You can find me at Kristian Harloff, Twitter and Instagram. And one thing I have to say is if you have not watched the La La Land sketch with Mr. Jeremy Jahns over there, it's on the YouTube channel right now, and it is awesome. That man can act. The crew really did some great job writing, and it just shows you what we're doing on Awesome Tacular. Go and check it out. Support it. It's great.
Directed by Dennis Zen, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sitting over there, Miss Ashley Mova.
Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, Ashley Mova. Happy Monday, guys.
And right beside her, Miss Wendy Lee.
On YouTube at the Movie Couple channel and on Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat, at Wendy Lee Zaney.
You guys can follow me simply on Facebook and on Twitter, just at John Campea. That'll do it for us, guys. Thanks so much for joining us, and until next time, bye-bye.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.